I think we're ready. I think we're ready. Who's ready? We're good. Hey, awesome. Hey, welcome to Team Stream number 7. I'm your host, Brad Muir.
Wow.
This is my lower third there.
That's pretty good. I'm hoping.
I love lower thirds. That's one of my favorite things. So, hey, welcome to Team Stream 7. Thanks for joining us. We're going to be going over a bunch of stuff that we've done over the last 2 weeks. The biggest thing is class design, hero class design. We have a bunch of cool ideas and visuals and stuff to show you. But first, also, joining me, as always, over here on the Wheels of Steel, Anthony Vaughn, producer on Massive Chalice.
What's up, peoples?
Joining me on Red Couch, I've got John Bernhelm. Nailed
Cheers.
It.
Lead
designer of Massive Chalice, and then Andy Wood, art director of Massive Chalice. Also, I would like to say, give another shout out to Chris Party, backer Chris Party, who sent us a bunch of beer. He didn't actually send us a bunch of beer,
he
right?
He did not because send us beer.
He did not send us beer.
Look so this is...
It's like the world's most appropriate surname.
Yeah. Oh, yes. It's so great. Cheers. So this is from the Clown Shoes Brewery. I love that name. It's called Porcine Unidragon. and it's an imperial stout aged in bourbon barrels, and it's amazing. And we're going to be enjoying it.
Cheers, Brad.
Hey, cheers to you guys.
Cheers,
and
people.
Cheers to you at home. I recommend an imperial stout aged in bourbon barrels for watching Team Stream 7.
Those are the only imperial stouts I'll drink. If they're not in bourbon barrels, I'm out of here. You know?
It's super awesome. And so shout out to Chris Party once again. Thank you for not sending us this beer all the way from Boston. okay, cool. So we're going to jump into this. I wanted to show these pictures because I just went home to Michigan. and
God, you're like a dad one. With an old
I know. It's awesome. I feel like you're all...
what do you like when you have kids?
I don't know what it's going to be
like.
It's
going to be like an apocalypse
crazy.
Of images.
but I just love assaulting you with, like, this is like my own, what do they call that thing? The carousel thing with the slides on it?
The slide projector.
Slide projector. It's like my own slide projector going out into the internet. So here we go.
That's a good
here's my mom.
Is that limoncello?
This is, no, that's actually a really, like, weird-looking margarita.
That was mellow.
We always go... my parents pick me up from the airport when I go home, and we always stop in Mexican town. And so this is like me and my mom in Mexican town about to drink margaritas. A Scotch egg. Yeah, this guy knows what it is over here. Andy Wood knows what a Scotch egg is. I had never had one, and my mom, my parents, they like looked up a recipe.
It's quite a thing,
and they it's amazing.
It's heroin.
It's so good, and that was the first time they'd ever made them. And so it's a hard-boiled egg with sausage wrapped around it, and then it's baked, and
it's fried.
Oh, it's usually fried. Yeah, okay, yeah. So this was
this is
the at-home version. Yeah. But I highly recommend a Scotch egg to anybody out there who hasn't had one. This, I thought.
Yes.
So maybe,
that's,
yeah.
That's
so this is my older brother, and this is my younger brother, and this is me. Would you look at this? Is this amazing?
I think I have the same picture somewhere in my house, but with red
hair.
It's
not changed.
That's amazing.
It's not, yeah, exactly. My teeth are like the same size. Amazing. Okay, this was the reason I went home. This is my new niece. Her name's McKinley. She's the best.
And her battle furs.
She is. I love her little dress. She was amazing. And I got to meet her for the first time. And my fiance and I are going to be her godparents. And I'm so excited.
She looks like Paul Modib's little sister from Dune. She's like, he's the chosen one.
Yeah, she's a Bene Gesserit in training.
That's right.
And then my nephew is 4, and he's awesome. And I was battling him with Ninja Turtle weapons. It was incredible.
He likes Ninja Turtles?
Look at this baby. It's the cutest baby. Oh, my God. Aww, I was hanging out with this baby, and she's the best.
She's like, what? That face is great.
Yeah, she's just so awesome. And then I was hanging out with my mom a lot. And
terrifying your poor mother. Your poor mother.
And then this was like her christening. That was super cool.
No, wait, Brad, go back. Is that you stealing relic, doing relic research for the game?
Yes, right here.
That's a reliquary.
Yeah, awesome,
like,
right?
I need a femur.
Totally awesome.
Or
that's my nephew.
A not quite massive chalice, right? Because that was the holy
It totally was. Yeah, awesome. And then this is me holding the baby. She's awesome. Okay, this thing, I wanted to shout out La Puma's in Southeast Michigan in Rochester. One of the best Coney dog places ever. If you don't know what a Coney dog is, this is what it is.
Do you call it a Coney dog?
It's a Coney dog.
I thought it was like a hot dog or just a Coney.
You can just call it a Coney or you can call it a Coney dog. It's totally acceptable, but it's like chili, mustard, onions. That's it. It's so effing delicious. And we were doing some research on it to make sure it is a Michigan thing. It looks like it did originate in Michigan, not on Coney Island. It's whatever.
Are you sure?
And that my nephew hates getting his picture taken, which is sad. but that's it. It was awesome. Aww. And also, you know what? Brad, generational aspect of Massive Chalice, very much, you know, you applicable.
I don't normally do this, but I'm going back to another Michigan favorite, post beer.
Oh man,
Fago for you.
That's
Fago,
you know, that's a great chaser like a for an imperial thing? Stout.
Yeah,
yes. Great chaser, original Red Pop
put
from Fago.
Okay,
hey, let's get into some actual game stuff. So our first thing that we want to show you, and this is Andy is joining us for this part, is what we call a render target. So this is something that we produce. Do you want to explain a render target to the people at home?
The peeps.
To the fine folks at home?
I'm sure you would have done a fine job. so I guess it's our first attempt to try and show people what we're aiming for. And it's all of the pieces that we're working on separately at the moment pulled together into one sheet so that we can show it to people and be like, okay, this is really how we want the game to look. And it, you know, things might change, but it's our first best guess. And I guess we should point out that we don't have a rendering programmer yet, but we will.
Right, yes.
And so that's why we did this.
David Farrell will be joining the project on Monday. Yeah. Super fantastic graphics guru dude. And this is, and when you say people, like this is for people, it's primarily for like programmers to be like, hey, this is the look that we want to shoot for. These are the techniques that we think we'll be able to use. But then we want to vet it by the programmers, make sure that they like kind of tell us what is possible, what is not possible.
Yeah. And they might just turn around and say, we can't do that.
Exactly, yeah. And they usually just spit right in your mouth when they say that, which is totally disgusting. But hopefully everything is fine.
A lot of people in the chat wondering if we're going to get a Batman class.
There might be, yeah, utility belts.
They spotted that, did they?
Yes, everyone's like, is that Batman?
There was an Easter egg in the render target. I guess people found it right away.
So this is also kind of like a one-sheet art Bible in a way.
Yeah,
in some
a little
way.
Bit.
It's like it can help us build into those things, right?
It's the Cliff Notes of our Bibles.
I mean, like, we have people like Jeremy and other people come on doing pieces of art. Like, this will hopefully help. You know, it's an easy way to remind you, like, okay, what are the things I should be putting into these art pieces?
So I thought we could go through all of these call-outs that you had on here, Andy. So this one, this is for trying to do some faceted stuff. Have that be, like, a real cornerstone of the art style.
Yeah, and I call it out several times on this sheet, but what we're trying to do is choose where those facets live so that we don't have a whole screen full of hard edges that gets really noisy. So so we picked them out on the rocks and the trees because it's a good place. That's non-playable stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be off to the edges of where your characters are, so it's a little bit less distracting.
And also those things can be really big, right? Yeah. It's like they're larger things. So you don't have a lot of like polygonal edges. You have like a lot of flat surfaces with it. And when you say a facet, you mean like the hard polygonal edge that you're actually seeing.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to help the non-artists like
but
myself.
The edges might be hard and sharp corners, and the stuff in between might be soft. It might
like a
not
scotch
be complete,
egg.
Like
a scotch egg.
Like the cut through a scotch egg.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So right here on these trees, like this is just a good example of like how we want them to be abstract and not necessarily super realistic on the designs.
What we're getting up there with the trees and then with the stuff on the edges of the vegetation and the stuff in the shadows is that if we have multiple regions across this world, we want to start introducing some shape language into those regions so that might be identifiable visual signifiers of where you are. Like, there might be more triangles in one area's color set and in their tree shapes and in their rocks and things than you would see in another world that might be a bit more square or something like that. So trying to put a little bit of space and visual difference in between each of these regions just with simple things like that.
Wanted to jump over here to this part. So on the edges where we go from like one texture into another one, this is that that technique that we're totally from Animal Crossing, which it looks really cool. It definitely fits with the faceted polygonal kind of feel of the game. And so this description, you know what? I only understand half those words. So, yeah, it's a one-bit alpha blend rather than like a soft blend that
you would see. Yeah, so it's a harder edge on those transitions. And also, because the playable area is going to be flat, it's a way to get some of that geometric faceted feel from the rocks and the 3D geometry into that flat
onto the
plane.
Playable space, yeah. Which is super cool.
And the same with the shadows in the trees. Like what we're trying to show here is that the vegetation, the leaves and whatnot of the trees might look different to what the shapes are in the shadow, but the shapes in the shadow would be tied more into that regional shape language.
And how would we pull that off? Would there actually be like totally different shadow casting geometry?
That's one way to do it. Or we can put like a texture in a light and project that down. So I'm not sure. We need to talk to David about what's the best way to do that.
Cool. And then there's
we're going to talk about this. I was just going to ask about the hatch mark noise in the shadows.
Yeah, so if we can zoom in on this. So this idea was to try to get a little bit of different texture going on a surface when it's in shadow.
Yeah, like that shader we've been toying around with. I think it's just another way for us to break up all of the flat surfaces with something interesting and have something that's got a little bit of a graphical feel, some style to it. That's not overly distracted.
Sure.
And that'd be four areas in Fog of War.
Yeah. I think so.
So Andy, is one of your big challenges, because that can look like, we know what the intentions of those hatch marks are, right? But like, could that look like a corruption in the graphics or something like that?
It's funny, because the first pattern that Derek played around with looked exactly like when our shadows break.
Oh, cool. So do you find yourself on that fine line type thing with this?
Well, we haven't tried it yet, so I think when we try it, we just need to figure out something that doesn't look busted and go with that one.
Yeah.
So then this is the stuff you were talking about with the shadows, how like you have some like softer shapes that are casting shadows, as opposed to the really hard stuff that you would see from forms like these. Like if we were just shadow casting these, they would put real like long, thin, jaggy kind of things.
Yeah.
So this is like a way of getting like a little bit smoother kind of thing. That seems cool. Let's talk about this for a minute. Well, on the heroes, let's see. Okay, yeah. So this stuff, like this call out in the hero, doing more of these like faceted things on the faces. So these are the Soviet statues.
So those are the Soviet statues. And the thing I love about those faces is that they're not, it's kind of the same as what we were talking about with the rocks. You don't want to see every single triangle because then it gets super noisy. If you scroll over to the orange guy at the right, those models are much more faceted and the faces on them get a bit too noisy. Mm-hmm. So I prefer when...
The Soviet style.
Yeah, it's more specific planes and areas and regions on the faces are bounded by a hard edge, but the stuff on the inside is soft. Like if you look at the cheek and the thing under the eye, the surface under the eye, you can see it's not a bunch of triangles. It's just like flat planes with a hard edge. And it helps with readability, I think.
Cool. And then this, and then the Batman here that everybody immediately saw. You can't put a fucking Batman anywhere these days, you know, without somebody immediately.
It was kind of a ploy. Then I wouldn't have had to talk about anything. It was just like put Batman in, and everybody will talk about Batman.
That's that character from those movies.
But this is super cool because we found this very very early in our exploration. This is like it's actually a statue, right?
I put that in because it's a statue. It's not a Mignola painting. It's a 3D figure.
Right, but this is based off of like a Mignola.
Right, and
Batman.
It shows that you can pull it off in 3D if you want it. So so that's why it's in there.
And the idea here is that this to try to do a shader that gives us a little bit of harder edges on the shadows rather than smoothing them out. Like right here under his nipples, right here.
Or we could look at his abdominals.
Let's look at his abdominals instead. Let's look here. Yeah. But how you have like this?
Taking it weird, Brad.
I'm sorry. That's weird. That was the first thing.
He's got
that,
all kind of rippling.
I'm sorry. Whenever I see a Batman, the nipples immediately jump out at me. But this, these parts right here, where it's like the I don't know how to describe this correctly.
Touching the nipple?
No, this is his ab.
Oh, you're rubbing high up.
I'm just rubbing his ab.
With your little bit,
as you would with Batman.
Yeah, washboard abs.
A stud. Yeah.
Just like, playing in the jug band on Batman's. Abs.
Your Batman-like meter is increasing.
Everyone who's played GTA 5. It's just to get this real hard break on the shadow, right? to get this hard break on the shadow so that like the top of the ab is like very much lit and then the bottom of the ab is very much not lit and you just get that real hard break on the shadows.
And you kind of shadow chunks too. There's a couple that are a little bit darker, but like it's not, I like it. I mean, there's most of it is in just between a couple different ranges.
Yeah, cool. And there's one other cool thing, which is if you look on the belt, they put the zigzag edge in the middle
right here.
There. Yeah, and then the one at the left.
And then here?
Just like in Mignola's art where he does that to break it up.
Right.
And I really like that. And that kind of slightly broken up edge that's almost like a hard shadow, but still got a little bit of something going on in the edges is something we talked about a lot, trying to get in that shade.
Sweet.
So, yeah.
And we'll see how possible...
Textures.
We'll see how possible all of this stuff is.
Yeah.
I think that we hit everything that...
Ion 900 had a really good idea. If this was to be an unlockable hero, Batman, both of your parents must die in battle in front of the character. Then you can unlock...
Oh my god. That's sweet. We could have some sort of Dark Knight class.
Yeah, child must fall down the well. You'd be freaked out.
Okay, that is super cool. So basically, we make this... we made this so that we can have like a really clear idea of what we're shooting for when we bring programming on and we say, hey, like these are the rendering features that we really need. How can we get to this look? Because we think that this is how we want the final game to look. It's kind of like, and then also while they're like messing around with, you know, implementing this stuff, they can constantly come back to this as the target and be like, how close is this technique to the initial sort of like, you know, rendering that we did? And like, yeah, it just helps get a little tighter iteration loop for a graphics programmer, which I think is really, really good in the process.
And we're also trying to mock up as much of this stuff as we can, like, you know, how we're working. If there's anything that we can do with the tech we already have that can kind of get us close, then we're trying to do that too. So.
Okay. Sweet. Anybody on the chat, we're going to let Andy go here in a minute, but if anybody has any questions about, like, render target and like any of the techniques that we're talking about here or whatever, that would be fantastic.
Yeah. Aside from the nipples, that was just awkward.
Derailed.
And I think one thing that, and again, because I'm not an artist and I actually don't know as much about shaders as I'd like to, one of the things that's kind of a mystery to me when we started moving from games where like texture mapping was king to moving into shaders being the king, and like materials are this combination of textures, many different textures representing different layers, and then shaders. Like, how does this apply to how we're going to be building the or painting textures for our models and stuff? Like, what parts of this do you think is going to be done in shaders by a graphics programmer versus texturing when we make models?
I'm hoping most of it will be coming from the shader and will not be really painting a lot of custom individual one-off textures because that's a time intensive thing.
Right. So we like kind of drop vertex colors or like color everything, like just do like very basic kind of color blocks?
I'm hoping that a lot of the geometry and the patterns that you see in the textures there will come from layering in textures that we use in different combinations. So we'll have like sets of certain geometrical patterns in different suites of color that we can interchange and mix together, and then painting the blends in vertex colors on the mesh to mix that stuff together will give us those edges.
Okay.
And then on the characters, I'm thinking because of the size that they are on screen, we won't have to do a lot of detailed texturing.
Right.
So we won't be painting in eyeballs and things like that.
We're not going to be like ZBrushing up a lot of stuff in this game. So.
No, yeah. I think we might be doing that for the terrain. We're experimenting with that right now. But at this kind of, you know, level of detail in the geometry, it's not really what people think of when they think of ZBrush Central.
Right.
Like multi-million polygon.
Yeah.
Bald veins.
No.
Yeah. Wrinkles. We're not doing wrinkle
arm
maps.
Veins.
It's like an ant's view of the one of those.
Marcus Phoenix
models.
Is not going to be in this game.
No.
Sorry.
So a couple questions came in.
Cool.
One thing I think is just a misunderstanding, but Shade Delthor asks, why not have the trees give shadow? That seems natural. And our trees will give shadows, right? But maybe we'll use different meshes for them? What are you thinking on that?
Well, they will give shadow, but I wanted I wanted to experiment with the shadows not necessarily just being the true cast shadow of the foliage on that tree, like trying to do something that's a little bit more graphic with it, that feels a bit more sketchy and a bit less representative.
And hopefully, like, you won't even notice.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the kind of thing where you might not put together that there isn't, like, a one-to-one perfect correlation between a tree and its shadow. It should just, like, it just enhances the feel and the look of the game without actually impacting, like yeah, it's not realistic, but it, you know.
It might be a bit more cohesive is what I'm thinking.
Exactly,
so
yeah.
I want to play with that.
Sure. Yeah, and that's great that we're, you know, we're pulling back the curtain and telling you all of our tricks before they happen.
Right.
So that you'll be very, very dissatisfied with the look of the game, whereas if we just shut up,
then you'd only then, be very dissatisfied.
Yeah, you'd only be slightly dissatisfied. So, you know.
That's right.
Sorry about
that. And I can see that breaking up some of that, like if we have a string of trees and they're all kind of up like this, you know, you don't want them just duplicated in shadow underneath and then you have all of these straight lines going in two directions. So I think that sounds really cool. I'm excited to see how.
So some more ones for you, Andy. This is actually a really good one to know. Oki G asks, do these render targets tend to change much throughout development, at least after this point? You're going to show this to our graphics programmers. Will there be any tweaks to this down the road, do you think?
Yeah, I would imagine. I would imagine, especially if we get told we can't do what we want to do. So, yeah, I mean, it's a target. It's not meant to be the be-all, end-all. And it's a circular process, so some of this stuff is based off of what we've already made and we know works, and some of it is speculation. So we'll combine and keep on combining that stuff until we get something that's
great,
you know.
And definitely taking it to programming, seeing what is possible, what's not possible. Some of it, it's probably all possible. It's just that, like, can they cram it into one shader?
Right.
Will it be efficient? Will it render at a, you know, will it be performance? Like, all these other things. Like,
how long will it take to do?
Right? Yeah. There'll be a lot of back and forth as we go with, you know, in talking with programming, and then it's just some back and forth stuff. And we might revise this. We might not. You know, I mean, there's not.
Well, we shouldn't rule out the possibility that something we get might not look like the image, but might give us an opportunity to do something better that we hadn't thought of.
Right.
So I don't want to rule that out. You know,
sure.
We get this stuff in, we get it working, and we test it, and maybe it gives us something we never thought of that just looks awesome, and we go with that instead.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
one of
great.
The cool things about our tech is that, like, almost every Double Fine game has a very different rendering. There's just a lot of different rendering styles we've played with this tech, from Once Upon a Monster to Stacking to Brutal to Trenched to The Cave. Like, I think that's really cool, and it's exciting that, like, our tech and artists here have been able to figure out ways to make everything look different. So if you look at the Amnesia Fortnite games, like Autonomous, I didn't even know that Autonomous uses this. You were talking about the edge shader for that. I didn't even know it had a special crazy edge shader that
the whole facet, the way that it picks out the facets, like we're looking at using some of that same tech for picking out the facets on these rocks and things. That was a very big part of the look of that game.
Yeah.
And they did that one within, you know, 2 weeks. Yeah, we've got some smart dudes on the programming
super side.
So a couple more questions. This is kind of two questions kind of in one. So will quirks, like something like asthma or some sort of trait, how will that show up in the character models? Will they be the models themselves? And then kind of more general question, but similar depth but related. How do you plan to show like the colors and sigils on the battlefield? That's obviously a big thing for our backers.
Yeah.
So I guess it's like the general question is like uniqueness in these characters, specifically talking about bloodlines and sigils versus things like asthma or maybe they have extra strength.
The how quirks, would you show that? I think the whole trait system is, I don't think that we'll actually have visuals for any of those things.
Probably not on the characters themselves. Well, unless we have a real, I don't know, unless there's like a real good way to do one that will do, like, the only one that sprang to mind, this is kind of disturbing, but like, hemophiliac, like they just keep bleeding.
They're trying to sneeze and bleed.
I don't know, but like you probably don't want that. But we think that we can express most of that through UI.
Or like limps, for example. I guess limp could be a trait. Like always.
Anything that requires additional animations and VFX work for a trait will probably be expressed through UI. Just because it's an expensive thing to do for a trait, and we'd rather we'd rather do more traits than fewer ones that have that are expressed through animation.
Yeah, I mean, in a perfect world, it would be sweet to do like custom attachments, custom VFX, custom animations, custom all this stuff for things like traits. But I think that the system, you know, it's just, I think it's more mechanical than visual.
And it's not that we, you know, can't think of ways to do this or couldn't do it with given an infinite budget and time, but we just don't have those things. We have to kind of pick where we're going to spend the animation time.
Oh, and then the other question was about
colors and sigils.
Colors and sigils.
Yep. Yeah. Well, we have that in mind when we're looking at the characters all the time. We've talked about that a lot. The quick answer is we haven't decided. The longer answer is, we have that in mind, and as we go further and further with the characters and we start nailing down the classes that you're going to see next, we will just have to start making room for where those things live. Sigils on the character is a tough one because the characters are so small.
Yeah.
So,
and that leads,
we have other options.
That's a perfect segue into the last question, is from GreenBee3, about the characters, about their size, about their involvement in the environment. It seems like they could easily get lost in the environment. Perhaps in this picture, the grass texture sort of matched them, who knows. But what ideas do we have to make them sort of pop on the battlefield?
Well, that we do have that in mind as well. Simplifying the battlefield as much as we have done is kind of the main reason behind avoiding that. That fear is the main reason behind simplifying things as much as we are doing. The flat playable space is a big advantage to us, so we just need to make sure that we don't overbusy that with overpopulation, super strong textures, and that's a big reason for making sure that the faceting doesn't really go across the whole screen, so that the characters will have that faceting on them, and specifically on the limbs and the body more than the head. But the ground itself will be smooth, so hopefully that'll be a big step forward for, you know, making them pop. Plus, they'll always be moving, and then we have to choose with the colors. We already talked about having house colors that will be quite specifically tied with the houses and not just general colors that you would find everywhere in the world. So we thought of it. We just haven't thought of all the answers.
And then the sigils, like, I mean, it'll be cool if we can get them onto the armor or onto some part of the actual thing. But the big thing that we want to do with the sigils is that when you have the character selected, a big component of the UI will switch, you know, depending on the colors and the sigil. And that'll be really represented in the UI when you have that character selected, just to reinforce it.
And plus, in the strategic layer,
right?
Exactly.
Like, so I think that even if you don't see it, like, I'm kind of thinking that the primary secondary color of the house will be the most visible thing on the guy on the heroes when you see them from this perspective, and that if there is any sigiline on them, it's going to be pretty small. Even if we do like that test that we did during the Kickstarter of it's like a huge tabard, and it's like the sigil on that, you know, from this perspective,
it'd be still small,
very very small, and that's taking up most of the character.
There's just no getting around that.
And so I think that it's better to just punt on that and just really lean into the colors as much as possible, and then have the UI be the thing that really displays the sigil. And then in the strategy side, you know, seeing the sigil on banners and on...
Yeah, when you go into that keep view, seeing it adorning the keep. And so you'll definitely feel that these characters are a part of that house with the sigils being represented,
right,
even if they don't have it everywhere. I mean, think about the little country flags on the back of the XCOM guys. Like, first off, it doesn't make any sense from real life, because why are these guys like running around with like, I'm from South Africa on the back of his neck? And secondly, those things were really hard to see most of the
time.
And they didn't really add a lot to the game. So we got some exploration to do there, but I think that we're going through all the trouble to make the sigil system and to give you guys the Bloodline backers the ability to put them in, so we want to show them off in the best way we can.
That's great.
Cool.
Thanks, guys.
Cool. Okay, sweet. Andy, thanks for joining us.
I'm settled in now. You're getting this.
Yeah, I know.
It's pretty really strong.
Yeah, it is a little bit.
Maybe we could turn the cameras off while I get up in case I fall over.
Well, we're gonna move on and start talking about the design of classes. And if you could summon a Derek,
I will see
that
if
would
I can
be
do
excellent.
That.
Thanks, Paul.
All right, guys. Thanks very much.
Okay. Thanks, cool. Andy.
Okay, so we're gonna talk about class design. Class design. Hey, this is what we've been spending the majority of our time on over the last couple weeks. So I want to go to this guy. Hey, Paul, is this being clipped as well?
Yeah, just keep it inside that. Yeah,
okay, cool, cool. I can do my best. I can do my best. How would I do that? Oh no, I've got a great idea. I've got a great idea.
Ah, there you go.
I've got a great idea. The current window is too small. Thanks, Google. I just closed that, right?
Yeah, it was still too small.
It's still too small. Okay. Whoops.
Whoa.
Okay, cool. That seems great, huh?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Derek. Beautiful.
Hello.
Hey.
A wild Derek appears.
Sorry about that. Hey, Derek Brand is here.
Derek
Brand. Everybody's favorite concept artist. Derek Brand has joined us on the couch. Hey. So we're gonna start with the design side of classes and what we did. So first it was John and I discussing classes and what we liked and didn't like about these systems.
And these lists were kind of like day one.
This was very, very early. Like, very early in the process.
Let's make archetypes.
We also, I feel like the big thing for me was like I wanted hybrid classes to be part of the game. And this was like, how could we actually do it? You know, and how many classes would we need? And this sort of like, you know, you see this simple one here where it was like warrior, archer, mage. Warrior, archer, mage, and then you get, so you have three base classes, and then you have three, like, customized hybrid classes. And that was like, okay, and that sort of makes sense. This one was a little bit weird. What's your archer, mage? The other two make a lot of sense, right?
He's like the AoE archer who's, like, barraging. He's like the mortar guy. He's like mortar fire guy. And brimstone from above.
And then we were like, okay, that, you know, what does it look like with more? And what we were discovering is that you quickly, you know, just by adding like two more classes, you end up with like a huge number of hybrids and it becomes like kind of untenable. So we were like, okay, maybe it's just, you know, more like Final Fantasy Tactics where they aren't custom. This is sort of taking the custom class route for hybrids in this one as well, where like a ranger doesn't necessarily have any of the same abilities as a warrior or an archer. He's got like his own stuff going on, you know? I'm gonna move this out. Paul is helping us with all of this. Is that good? Looking okay?
Yeah.
All right? Maybe? Sorry. Technical difficulties. We're putting tape on this giant TV. It's amazing. Okay. Cool, cool. Okay, so yeah, so we were realizing that like custom hybrid classes were really hard. So maybe we can go with a system where more like Final Fantasy Tactics, where it's like you are a primary class and then you have abilities from a secondary class, and that's sort of where we are now.
A little different as well.
Yeah, a little different. But
we were originally thinking about like having two separate skill trees, and I think we want to do a custom skill tree per hybrid. Mm-hmm. That is a combination of the two other ones.
That mainly cherry picks out of both classes.
That really lets us, like, you know, balance them well and make them unique.
But this was, you know, we're just trying to take you through the whole process here where it was like, you know, this was just to make sure that, like, hybrid classes could be a thing and that they would be interesting and, you know, maybe there's a way to do that and cool. So then a couple weeks ago, we had a huge team brainstorming session where everybody threw out their most ridiculous ideas and everything here was about, like, so we had a melee section, a range section, and then a kind of like magic support or other section. And we just threw out all these ideas that were really the only constraint was that it couldn't be something that you had really seen in another fantasy game or a video game or a movie or something. So a lot of these things, like a bullfighter or like, a keto dude, like a judo master, or like, oh, badass Moses. a dude with a big shepherd's crook that could like pull guys around. There was like a chef or a butcher, a beekeeper. I don't know, just all sorts of like ridiculous thing. What was the most ridiculous thing that came out of here? Cheerleaders?
I don't know why cheerleaders.
I mean, oh, well, just like Just like a ton of Ghostbusters.
Tuning Fork Guy was the most
Tuning Fork Guy
thing, and we
we'll get to that. Later, so that was kind of like our next step was just like, okay, like let's take the best ideas, and you can see the ones outlined in green or yellow were the ones that we really liked the best. And we'll get into those from there. But okay, so from that, I believe the next step. Yeah, okay. Oh, there was one other thing that I wanted to share with you that I thought was kind of cool. So this was, so John sort of took a stab at this, like, well, what are just sort of interesting archetypes or whatever that we've seen in other things? And this was kind of an interesting way to go. And then it also drove you to this, this crazy spreadsheet that I really like, where it starts with this over here, where you have, like, adjective one that describes kind of like the personality of or the job of the person, adjective two, which is like what kind of world they live in, and then the actual noun, like what their actual job is. And then you can mix and match these things to end up with like berserk octopus watchman. And it's like, what the hell is that? You know, like what could that be? And sometimes these sort of like word association things really lead to like foolish frog archers. Like, what does that mean? It can just sort of lead you to like kind of weird, stupid, interesting ideas. And oftentimes those ideas are really, really terrible, but somebody will hear them and then have an idea that's legitimately good that you can springboard off of, and that's really good. And that's why they always say that there's, you know, no bad ideas during brainstorming. There actually are bad ideas during brainstorming, but the thing is that bad ideas can actually trigger really good ideas. So you don't want to put the like the smackdown on bad ideas. Just because all those like bad, dumb things that you say can actually lead to something really, really cool.
And it can be helpful to go through exercises like this just to kind of wake your brain up and like get out of the box and start looking at things. And this was kind of inspired by, and I always forget their names, but the two characters from...
Blue Man Group?
No, from Game of Thrones. This is not spoilers because it was in the entire last season. So, but if you haven't watched the whole last season of Game of Thrones, you probably should. But the two kids that were from the mud village of the frog eaters.
Yep.
Like they're basically, I was like, okay, well these characters are interesting. You know, they walk around with tridents. They're like really good at natural stuff. There's also one that's kind of a green seer and he kind of can see the future and they're kind of mystic. And, but they live in a hidden village, almost like Naruto, like a ninja clan. And so if I were to describe them, I would call them, mystical swamp ninjas. And I'm like, that sounds kind of cool. Like a mystical, you know. Mystical Swamp Ninja sounds like something you could make a class out of. So it kind of broke, that's what kind of got me thinking this way. And didn't have a lot that came out of this, but I think it did help kind of break some stuff out. Like you could have stealthy owl alchemists. And, you know, you can imagine, I mean, that, you know, that character from The Watchmen is kind of like a stealthy owl alchemist. He's like, you know, technology
sure.
dude, you know, like,
yeah.
Like some of these things actually exist, so.
Okay,
this was fun.
So this was like just kind of like a cool whatever, and we had the ones back from over here where I was gonna go back to easily from this team brainstorm that we liked the best, and John kind of collated them and made these kind of like one sheet documents about like the classes. So we'll just go through this one, and this was like okay the start. This was the last step before we went to like a visual exploration. So we're like, okay, like we really like this idea of a dude that is like. A football player meets a caber tosser meets a lumberjack.
And these are still just kind of collating all the things we talked mm-hmm. about in meetings. So these are not super formal documents. They're just kind of throwing a bunch of stuff into a doc.
And none of these names are like final, although the name Caberjack is
that's
super badass.
Staying.
So
we're probably just
going to go
it's
with
awesome.
This one. But the Caberjack is, you know, this really, you know, football lineman and a caber tosser and a lumberjack all put together. We like the football pads kind of look. We thought that could, like, medieval football pads could be really badass looking.
Especially because we're going with the same, like, basic build for the characters, but we need to use the armor to break the outlines out. So this felt like a natural way to do
and then
that.
There's some exploration, this early exploration of, like, what his weapon could be like.
I thought it would be a log with a batlift connected to it.
Oh, man, that's literally
that
the nerdiest thing.
Yes.
Look at this log
so
with the batlift on it.
I photoshopped the log with the batlift, and bam.
And then
my paycheck now. Thank
some
you.
Ideas, some ideas about like skills. You know, thinking about this character being all about like positional control, like a lot of knockback stuff, being able to throw friendly units around the battlefield, or I don't know, all sorts of like things. And then some reference of like characters in other games or other media. This is just like a good way to sort of like get get, you know, sort of see what else is out there that's similar, so we can stay away from it, really, I guess. And then some stuff, some like real world images, like these caber tossers, and like these are just kind of like, this is basically just creating a bunch of fodder to send into Derek's brain, is what this is, you know? Oh, and the one thing, I don't know if it's on here or not. Oh, it is. This stuff, so the battering ram, I really like this idea, and this was kind of the initial direction that we sent to Derek. Modern day SWAT team battering rams have this really cool dual-handed, it's not really a weapon, but it's a piece of equipment that is wielded by a single person.
You wouldn't want to get hit by it.
As opposed to like old school battering rams that were like these huge logs carried by a bunch of dudes. So we really like this was a great place to start, I thought, for the thing, and we'll show you what came out of it. Also, it's a great place to put random things. John found sheaf tossing, where this is where you take a pitchfork and you get, what is it? Is it a hay thing? What's in there?
It's like a sack with a bunch of weight in it that's supposed to represent like a hay bale. But you have to like flip it over your head over this bar behind you. You can kind of see it behind.
So it's like, it's like kind of like a high jump, but you're doing it by pitchforking this thing. So this is a Scottish Highland game.
There's some cool pictures of people doing this.
Yeah, where you like toss this thing over your back. Look at this guy. This guy's the best. This guy's the best. So it's like, yeah, it's a really ridiculous, weird sport, and it's awesome.
Remember what Andy was telling us in England, what they call the police call the battering ram, the master key?
Yeah, the master key. It's super awesome. So John did these for all of them, and you know, I'm just gonna, whatever. We have them, and that's cool, and you have to trust me, because we're gonna get into the visuals, because that's, everybody likes visuals. So from there, we threw it to Derek, and he drew a bunch of stuff for a while. And
This
is what came out of it right here. Okay, sweet.
Bam!
I'm going to zoom in on this. Zoom in on this guy. Hold on. Stand by. I want to make sure it fits to the screen so we don't miss out on any of this stuff. Okay, so the first one we're going to go through, top guy here, we're calling him the Vanguard.
For now. All these are just flux.
So the Vanguard character, we wanted a lightly armed kind of duelist character that fights in melee combat, you know, like lightly armored. And it is about like parries and riposte, and is kind of like a duelist fencer kind of type character. But he's also, we were calling them Captain originally, because he's all about like buffing allies, calling out weak points, or like giving other people additional, like calling out, spotting enemies, giving characters additional attacks or additional movement points, just really like controlling the battlefield as a melee support character, right? That's like really his role. So,
yeah. Can I clarify this part of the process too? This is like taking all the images that John and Brad and everyone's are talking about, and just like shotgun, scattergun approach of just like, right, here's all this stuff.
Absolutely. That, it's like just throwing a bunch of spaghetti at the wall and seeing what sticks in a visual way. Mm-hmm. And also there are tons of crazy ideas. We'll get to some of them in a minute.
Yeah.
But we had a lot of crazy ideas of like, you know, we could easily have this guy be shouting. So he just has like a fencing sword and then he shouts at characters, or, you know, and there's some kind of, what's the word for that? There's some like barbarian characters that shout in fantasy games. That's kind of like an established thing. Bards. You're such a bad person. Why would you bring up bards? Oh my God, you're the worst. So like, that's kind of an established thing. We could do that, but we're like, what if, you know, is there another way that he can make those noises through his weapon, through something else? And so, yeah, I made you draw.
So it's like a lot of like really weird,
really weird, random crazy stuff, and we're gonna get into it.
A barbarian.
So first you did some like exploration of like his armor. I really like this. This was kind of like taking some of the captain-y stuff. Like this is like medieval epaulets and things like that, and some fringe and like frilly arm puffs and stuff. I don't know about arm puffs. Jeff really likes the arm puffs if he's watching this. I don't know if he'll go back and watch this. I really like this one. This is super great. Like these one. Awesome. And this was cool that you really start with. Can you talk about this a little bit? This sort of abstract stuff?
Yeah. It was just trying to find a shape that could be easily recognizable and to start to think about them as an icon, you know, so that you have
And that's mainly distinct. Because, you know, top-down isometric, we're so far away from the dudes, they almost are reduced to icons. Like, even though they're fully 3D, we're not, like, you know, pulling a Supreme Commander where we literally turn them into icons. But they kind of become more iconic as you pull out. So it's just thinking about, like, having all the classes be different, you know, and this is the same for all of them. You just think about, like, what they could actually look like.
Yeah, it's like a knee-jerk reaction of what that shape could be, and it'll probably change as we develop
or
them.
Or the Peter Chan trick of squinting your eyes.
Oh, yes.
The thing will become, you know, more silhouette-like. All the details will start to fade away, and, you know, so with this guy, he could just sort of be an X, I guess. That's a little artsy for me, but I think it works.
If you're nearsighted, you can just lift your glasses up.
Okay, so that was, like, this is really cool, and, like, this kind of leather armor with the X motif is super, super badass. So now we're getting into, like, what could the, you know, could the sword, his kind of duelist sword, be the thing that makes noise? So here you were thinking that it has this gap in it above the hilt, and when he swings it, it sort of whistles. It, like, makes noise. So that's actually cool just for, like, his basic attacks. It just, like, it just whistles and it makes noise. But also he can, like, swing it over his head or do, like, the cross-cutty, the Conan. Jeff referred to this as the Conan, where you're, like, twirling the sword and do that really fast, and it would make noise. And that seems pretty cool. And that could be, like, the various, instead of, like, shouts, it could be, like, the whistling sword that,
different,
like, makes
patterns,
these noises that do it. Then, I'm sorry, I made you do this. So my idea was to do a sword that's also a vuvuzela. So this is, like, it's a kind of like a hollow conch shell sword, and he would blow into the end of it. Just the worst idea. And you had to draw it, and I apologize. But you know what? You gotta give it a shot, and it's terrible. It's just terrible. It looks like a piece of food for some reason.
It's just unsanitary, Brad.
And everybody was giving me shit for, like, having to put your lips onto a sword. It's like, you're not putting it on the sharp end, but everybody was like, no, blood could totally get on there. You don't want to put your mouth on that.
Gross.
Oh, jeez.
Demon
guys.
Blood. Do you know where those demons go?
So that was a really bad idea, so I'm sorry for that. But then, Derek, you had some bad ideas of your own. That's the great thing about this, is that we're all capable of bad ideas. So this was like, so it was like, oh, like, what if there was a buckler that was actually a noisemaker? It's like a hi-hat. So he's got a buckler that's a hi-hat, so when it gets hit, it makes a cymbal crash.
He's a one-man band and kills
machine. Or he hits his sword against his... It's a terrible idea, so we're not doing that.
You can tamperate it.
So this one was kind of cool right here. This idea was like, you know, could we take a whistle or a hunting horn and build it into, like, the basket hilt of a dueling kind of fencer blade. And that's cool. And I feel like that's an idea that I still really like. I'm not sure. Like, and there's this thing that I keep coming back to, which is, like, the pose that a fencer will do. And I wish Jeff was here, because he always corrects me. It's the salute that fencers do right before they fence. And they have that cool basket hilt on the foil, and they put it up to their face like this. So I was thinking, like, oh, if you did that, and then it had a horn, you know, you're blowing into the horn, that could actually be kind of sweet, maybe. It's kind of cool.
Really?
I don't know. That one's kind of cool.
It's kind of cool.
It's kind of cool.
I'll meet you halfway on that.
So this one was hilarious. This is a horn mask for Tootin'. I don't know if you guys can read that. But the idea somebody had, I don't remember whose idea this was, and it's actually kind of cool, was that the Bob Dylan harmonica holder. Oh, that's pretty good. It's like, could you build in a hunting horn holder into the neck part of the armor? And it's sort of hard to read, but the concept is still there. It's just, I don't know.
It's kind of awesome.
Yeah, we did run into this other problem where with hybrid classes, you're going to wear your primary class's armor and then use your secondary class's weapon. So it's an additional constraint on this stuff. So if you were not a Vanguard, but you were a secondary Vanguard, you would have to pull out the weapon and then be able to use the horn part of it. And if it's built into the armor of the Vanguard, it actually wouldn't work, because you'd have the armor from another class and whatever. I guess that's sort of a really annoying constraint that we have to deal with. So I don't think we're going to be going with the horn mask for Tootin.
Yeah, so
a lot
of people are like most of the function, most of the weapon-based function of a class, or most of the function in general, be in the weapon.
Right.
That way it can be a bit more modular and can be given to somebody else.
This one was kind of interesting. This is like a kind of ribbed sword. A rib sword? A ridge. I'm going to say a ridge sword.
Ridge, better.
A ridge sword. Yeah, ridged. And it was, oh man, somebody knew the name of this. There's this hollow percussive instrument.
Oh man, yeah. Andy knew
it. Gyro?
Goya.
Gyro?
Remember?
Somebody in the chat will know.
Andy knew it.
I know Andy knew it.
And we looked it up.
It's basically like you rub it with a stick and it makes a noise. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it was like, could he like drag this, could he drag this, the ridged sword along his armor in a way that would like make some noise or something? And that's kind of cool. Here's another, like, this is also a super badass outfit with like these awesome coattails. That's super cool. And this is another shot of that, like the whistle sword that we really like. That's one of the leading ideas, spoilers. And then here's another one that's maybe not the best idea, where he's got a bunch of drums. This is percussion armor. It's awesome.
Goyro.
Goyro. That's right. Goyro. Okay.
I say goyro. That's something different.
So here's another idea. So actually, at this point, we had a second pass of these guys. We talked about the ones we liked and didn't like and kind of went back to it. So this right here, we were like, hey, like, what about tuning fork guy that we had on the brainstorming list? Like tuning forks make noises. Like, maybe we could actually have the sword be like a tuning fork, so that he can, and this was kind of cool. It's got like a spear, like a pointy spear on the back end, so you can like jam it into an enemy and then jam the, like, slap the tuning fork and it would like make the dude explode or something. That like seems
cool.
Kind of dope. I don't know. And this one, it turns out to that, like, this sort of look on a sword makes it look like it's from the future, which is, and you're attacking this problem right now, right?
Yeah, I think it's working out. I think we can make it not look like it's from Halo.
Sword.
But it definitely looks like, with these sharp angles, that was like, you and Jeff, I think, and Andy were talking about how these sharp, like, 45 degree angles make something just look, even if it doesn't have like electricity and like you know, techie bits on it and shit, it still makes it look like it's it looks like it's out of Phantasy Star Online to me or whatever, you know? It looks like a Phantasy Star sword. But the idea of like having the tuning fork be a weapon is pretty sweet. And so this is the other leading idea that we have, and we'll see where that goes. I think it's pretty cool.
Although I did discover there's a sound sword from Adventure Time.
No way,
yeah.
What?
I was trying to show it the other day, but it was a little busy. Yeah, we'll check it out.
We'll check it out.
It's different than this, but it's, it's kind
of
funny.
And then this was another idea of, like, jangly bits.
Hey-o.
Like, having some jangly bits on the sword. Like, it's almost like a tambourine or, like, a... Or, like, having... It was basically, we were talking about that...
Maracas.
That pirate sword that has the, like a nose ring at the end of it.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't understand, what that is or whatever. It's, like, just totally sweet-looking, though. It looks like a pirate sword. And it was like, hey, like, could you have a bunch of that stuff on it? So he would, like, menacingly shake his sword. I don't know if that one's working for me. This was a cool idea. This was taking that, the horn hilt... and turn it into a dagger that's sort of hidden inside the sword. This is a whistle dagger.
Kind of Power Rangers, Green Ranger style.
Oh man, and that's right. I forgot about that.
My brother had like the electronic, dagger flute, and
summoning your Zord.
Yeah, you'd pretend to like put it to your lips and then hit a button and it would, you know, da 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 or whatever. it was annoying as hell. I think I removed the batteries.
Amazing. Probably this is where we're at with this guy. The leading ideas are like this whistle dagger, the tuning fork sword, and then the like whistle sword. One of the ideas somebody had was to move the holes in the blade of like the whistle sword out to the end, so that like right here, you know, it really gets lost. You can't actually see it on him because it's like on the hilt. Also, somebody brought up physics that when you swing the sword, the like, you know,
the velocity on the end is going to be
farther out on the end, the faster it's going, and the easier it would be to make a whistling noise. So,
as someone who's spent many a childhood year taking a cardboard tube from Christmas wrapping paper and just whipping it around as fast as possible.
okay, cool. We're going to move on to the next one. Okay, so the second class is the Arbalist. So the core of this guy was, could we take like an NRA gun nut mixed with a modern-day sniper who loves crossbows? So it's all about like, you know, this is like our range class, possibly our stealth class. Anything else about that?
conservative class?
This was one inspired by Daryl Dixon from The Walking Dead, and just like he's a country boy, but he knows the woods. He's kind of a survivalist. Those other influence.
Right.
There was like survivalists, and just, you know, may have a lot of gear on him, really know how to survive out in the woods, but also be very fond of carrying lots of ammunition for his mini
different
crossbows.
Right, different kinds of arrows that he'd use, and then also a really like tricked out, complicated looking crossbow that's, you know, whatever. And let's get into these.
Do you have some of the reference that we used for that? Because remember that one crossbow picture we found that was like insanity.
Yeah,
was...
so we can go through. So this was like John's write up for the Arbalist. And
yeah, John found it, right? It's like some crazy...
Oh, and we really like this like poncho. We were like, yeah, that poncho is like really awesome. That seems super cool. It's like a man with no name, but with a crossbow. And then, yeah, here are like some crazy modern crossbows.
Yeah, but they look awesome when they're tricked out with the extra...
That one!
Yeah, this is totally awesome.
Holy hell.
And then I love that, John, in a lot of these, you were also finding women and old dudes and old people wielding these different weapons, and that's like, that's great Master Chalice reference. Super awesome. Yeah, look at this. Wow. Look at this lady with a crossbow. That's like, oh, and then some survivalist stuff. Hey, that's a magic card.
Your magic card for the day. And then this guy just obligatory.
Because he's
and
a
this
badass.
Is like, you know, it's great. We really needed...
look what it says on his bow.
Heaping Jaguar. Amounts of misogyny up in this video game. This is great reference. Hilarious.
From not Chuck Norris, apparently.
Back to this. Okay, cool. So that's where we were starting. And so this one right here, we'd like this asymmetry, but this crossbow is like tiny. So this was like, yeah, let's go with like a bigger two-handed crossbow. Also make it more visible from the top-down perspective. So the bigger ones we definitely like better.
And kind of move it away from Thief and Dishonored. Right?
Yes, there are a couple that look sort of like the dude from Dishonored or Thief. And this was kind of cool, starting to get into like the hanging stuff off of the costume, which is really cool. The crossbows look really mean, I think are super sweet. And then also, this is really cool, Derek, because it calls back directly to a lot of the stuff you did in the shape reference, and it reads really well. It's super awesome. I like it a lot. This is one of my favorite things. I don't know if we're gonna go with this, but I love these like mean-looking hooks coming off the front of the crossbow. Upward-facing hooks for crossbow uppercuts. Crossbow uppercut sounds awesome. Totally into it. And here's this like double layer. Oh, the reason why we might not do a kind of like bayonet thing is that we really want to emphasize that like this is a ranged class. You know, it should like that whole form and function kind of thing. You should not want to take this guy into melee combat. It's also kind of muddying the waters when it comes to the hybrid class. Like if you had, say, like we just looked at the Vanguard, who is a melee guy. If you had like an Arbalist Vanguard hybrid class, you would always want him to switch over to his sword to do a melee attack. And, you know, if he's got bayonet on the end of his crossbow, it's like you could use either one, and I think it would be confusing. So I think it's really cool to, like, it looks awesome. This double-layered cape is awesome. And we're starting getting into some of the ghillie suit stuff, which are those, like, burlap suits that snipers, modern-day snipers wear to be, like, hidden. And it was working out super awesome. So there's a lot of, here's the... Dishonored guy. and it's so cool, like when we have a concept that's like, this sort of looks like a different, you know, something we've seen before, it just really helps us kind of like define the space that we don't want to go in, which is good. And then we're getting into more and more strips and the hanging stuff, and I think that's a great way to differentiate this dude from the other classes. And now these are the revisions where we're focusing on more mean-looking crossbows and bigger crossbows, and then really kind of explore the stuff. Anything else you want to say about this stuff? I feel like I'm just rambling about your work and how awesome it is.
Sounds good.
And I enjoy it. And big mean crossbows and the hangy stuff. Just give them a very different silhouette from the other characters. Make them a lot easier to.
We were talking a little bit about the rocket launcher crossbow too.
Oh yeah,
which I was just drawing one, and it's pretty awesome.
Is it awesome? Yeah. Okay, sweet. So that was something RPG. That we talked about when we were reviewing this guy for the second time. Was that kind of just a dude with a crossbow? Like, what can we do to sort of like stretch it out and make it a little bit different from what you've seen before? And the two ideas we had, one was bazooka crossbow. a bigger crossbow that you would shoot like an RPG or a bazooka, kind of shoulder mounted. And that's, I don't know, I hope it turns out rad, because it sounds really cool. And there was another one that we were going to do. We talked about like the underslung crossbow, like a minigun, but we decided no, because mainly because the caberjack, we'll get to that later, that they would have a very similar stance and pose, and so that's out. But I thought there was something else. Oh, a sniper rifle, trying to do a really long crossbow, and like what that would look like and if that even makes sense and whatever. So we'll have more on that guy. But yeah, and there's also plenty of things like scouting traps, you know, the, bringing in more of the survivalist stuff. There's a lot of different like abilities that we can give this character. And then stealth is the other big thing if we want to go in that direction, which is great. Okay, so the next one is the alchemist. So for this dude, I think, you know what? I think it is time consuming, but I think it's cool to kind of scroll through these things.
I don't think there was a lot for this guy, actually.
Okay, so for this one, though, we really wanted to have a grenadier type character. So whereas the arbalist is a direct fire character, this is like the indirect fire character who can throw stuff over walls. And he's all about using some sort of weapon that delivers these potions to the battlefield. And we thought that a highlight basket is like a super weird kind of looking thing. Also a lacrosse stick or a giant glove. Like who's this Jen Ann?
Yep. Second Samurai Shodown 2 reference of the day.
Yeah. It's looking pretty good. Or a sling. Those were ideas. And then we had like a bunch of like different ideas. Like we would want this guy to be able to like throw healing potions and scatter grenades and all this stuff. Highlight stuff is really awesome for poses and just like these guys. I think you can easily die playing that sport. Is that true?
Yes.
You go to Miami and play highlight and then just
sport that exists.
And then just get killed. That's awesome.
Go to Miami and get killed.
And then there's like some, you know,
some like D&D and other examples.
Yeah, someone brought up the demo man with his like big his big grenades and stuff. Yeah, it's awesome. So cool. Let's go back over to here. So these were like the curved sweepy shape for this dude. This is the most abstract shit ever. You artist.
I don't know if that one really carried through, but it was just a place to start.
Yeah. It's super cool. It's super cool seeing this and how it turns into this dude with like all the stuff on his back. So this was one of the things that I liked the most, actually. Like one of the still leading ideas, which is, what is it? A chuck it?
A chuck it.
Yeah. Those things that you, because a highlight thing is a huge hook, like on the end of your arm. It's like gigantic. And we were like, what if it was more like a shillelagh that could throw things, and then somebody was like, oh yeah, like the thing that you grab the tennis ball and throw it for your dog kind of thing. And it's like, oh, that's cool. If he has like a bunch of potions, he can grab one with the chuck it stick and then fling it. Seems cool. And it's much cooler than just throwing it, because then when the weapon's unequipped, in the case of a hybrid class, you can still see the thing on his back. It's like, we definitely wanted to have a weapon.
You know what's cool about that? Another reason why you use a chuck it, your dog slobbers all over the ball. It's disgusting.
Yeah, I don't want to touch it.
So like in our game, like what if like it was so poisonous? Yeah, you can't touch it. Just grab one and get it out of there fast. That could be kind of good.
Good point.
So this was another idea of like having all of these potions that are underneath his cape. And we talked about this, and this is like also an exploration of like sort of like the lacrosse stick, which is kind of interesting. This is like a lacrosse stick mixed with the highlight sort of curve thing. And it's sort of rad. With this one, though, the big thing that we didn't like about it is that from the top-down perspective, you wouldn't be able to see the potions. You'd just see sort of a bulbous cape. We always want to try to keep in mind that, like, what would this character look from top-down, because that's the most important thing for the game. So here's another take on, like, trying to get the potions more exposed in the front and trying to get, like, the lacrosse stick kind of idea. And this is like, and we're really starting to like this, where the potions are going on the outside, over one shoulder in this kind of asymmetric fashion, just very visible, you know? This one was one of the favorites, because this dude has that really, he actually really follows that sweepy shape that you had to start with. And he's got, you know, the potions are very big and very visible across this sash, and he's got this sort of cool, like, triangular shape with, like, a heavy bottom. Which is cool and very different from some of the other silhouettes of the characters, and it's rad. There was also a brief exploration of the giant glove for throwing, but it ends up just kind of, and you know what, like I felt like a dick because I was the one who was sort of like slapping this one down a little bit. Some people really love the giant glove.
Who doesn't like Hellboy? I like Hellboy.
It's so first it looks more like it's for catching stuff than throwing stuff, because it's, you know, it's
I might. doodle some when I go to the weapons. Just a couple of gloves that might look a little more elegant.
Gloves. All right, I'm into it.
Just to see if it.
Yeah, it's an interesting idea, but it just kind of always ends up looking like Hulk hands to me. I don't know. Okay, so this guy, now we're getting into like fully exposed potions on the back, and I think that's really cool. This one has that same kind of problem of like just being a cape from the top. There was some sling exploration that is pretty cool here, I think, like kind of a cool sling with some potions on it. There was also this, I really dig this idea where he's got like a bucket that he carries in the front that has all the ammo, all the potions in it, and then he's slinging them out of there. It's kind of cool, especially because the pose is so different. It looks like a snare drum kind of like sitting off to the side, which is kind of cool. This dude just throws them. Just F it, no weapon necessary. But we talked about that, and it's like it really feels like he should have a weapon. This one, I think, of the first iterations was the one that we really liked, like really overloaded, asymmetric, kind of single-sided like group of potions. They're really huge on that side. Super, super cool.
And kind of out of it, we got this idea that like maybe his Overwatch ability is that if he gets hit, that one of the potions could go off.
Yeah,
and so one of the
taking
I like
a defensive posture, and then like if he gets hit with an attack, it like triggers a random potion to explode on him, and that seems cool.
And I'd like to, if we explore that further, like explore like what would he, if he knew that this was something that could happen, how would he shield himself? Like if that maybe the cloth that's there is actually more like an armor piece that has a head protection as well. So he basically, you should talk to Chad. Actually, Chad, our lead programmer, was telling me about his grenade training when he was back in the army, and how he got to do a live fire grenade exercise. And you have an instructor there wearing a blast suit in case you drop the grenade at your feet, and his job is to jump on the live grenade.
Holy crap.
And so, like, just it'd be interesting to look at those things. It's just like, what happens if everything goes wrong, and how do you protect yourself?
And how can I never get that job?
Yeah, I don't know. So, let's talk Chad. Chad has thrown live grenades. I have not.
One of our, you know what? I'm going to try to slide these over here so they're not covered up by that thing. Okay, so these are like the revisions, and one of the things that was actually wrong that I was like, yeah, can we like weaponize the lacrosse stick or like the highlight thing, make them more like brutal looking so that they could look like you could actually hit a guy with it. We talked about that afterwards, and we're like, you know what, like we again kind of like the arbalist with those hooks on the front of it, really want this character to feel like a ranged character and stay out of the fights. So these things like this weaponized lacrosse stick here is really cool. And like this, you know, this is like the highlight, the mini highlight basket turned into like a Wolverine claw or something. They're super rad, but they make you want to like run this character up and like abuse somebody in melee combat with them. And that's like not what we want you to do. So we actually, this is the one that we're kind of, that we like, that I think I like the most right now is the sort of chuck it or mini highlight stick thrower. And then this awesome bulbous shoulder with all the potions, and then also holding a potion in the offhand all the time, just sort of like, you know, it's a totally different pose from the other characters. It feels sort of like dual wielding. I don't know. It's really cool and very interesting. And then here's the last couple that we had. This one's kind of cool where it's like the dude just grabbing them out of the bucket, just run around.
Have
with a potion
some
bucket.
Candy.
Okay, so that dude is super cool, and then I think, okay, so we already went through the Caberjacks thing.
Guy's my favorite. So, I want to be a Caberjack in this game.
Anthony, you are a Caberjack.
Thanks, man.
Right, and that's okay.
So this was, I love this. The first shape is a giant rectangle. Because this is like our like super fully, you know, heavily armored frontline kind of fighter that's about pushing dudes around and stuff. It's really awesome. This first one is one that I like. I love this weapon. I think it's awesome. It's like, I like these crenellations on it, like having the, I don't know, just having like a cool battering ram head on a more modern day battering ram. Like it's like a medieval battering ram head on a more modern battering ram sort of shape with dual handles.
That was really mess cool. You up too with those crenellations. Like it's got the handles, like you said, for like the modern, like get the torque, but then the jaggies, that's gonna light you up. Derek, you're messed up, man.
And then this one, Some of these, so it's interesting because we're, you know, looking at that kind of modern day pose of like holding that modern battering ram and hitting stuff with it. And we just have to be careful that it doesn't become too modern looking or too whatever, too futuristic even. And that's, I feel like that's sort of where this one was headed into that. Sort of looks like a Demolition Man era cop or whatever that's like holding this thing. And it's like, it's really cool. It's really cool. But I feel like we need more things to sort of root it in fantasy or root it in like medieval stuff. This one really liked because this has like a lot of these shapes that come from like almost like those modern day bomb suits. You were just talking about those, like those crazy puffy bomb suits, but done in a very like hard
bear suits are
like armor looking version. And it's really cool. And then like this caber is, are we calling it a caber? I don't know what we're calling it. Whatever.
It's way shorter than a caber, but we I like the idea. We'll see where
it goes. And that was one thing is that when we talked about actually going, you know, looking at the caber stuff, is that those are very thin and super long, and that we have to keep the character confined to the 2 meter grid. So you can't be really like holding this thing that's like, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 meters tall or whatever. So I think the battering ram stuff is just a lot better in terms of like keeping the character compact. But this is like very cool with the ridges on it. This is just a dude with a log. Sometimes you just gotta draw a dude with a log. I totally get it. But that's cool for setting a like a baseline. This was some shoulder pad exploration. We didn't like this one as much. Looks a little futuristic as well. This I really like this one. This one's super rad, and it really gets across the like double-handled modern-day battering ram kind of weapon. Really speaks to the character's like pose and movements on the battlefield and stuff. I totally love that one. And this is and this was a totally badass idea to make his armor really asymmetric, his or her armor really asymmetric with this kind of like what do you call this thing up here? I don't know. It's like a holster. No, it's like a resting spot for the caber. So that, and you could totally see.
It's like a giant chopstick rest. One crazy chopstick.
A giant chopstick rest. So that he can put the battering ram caber thing up there while he's like running around and then kind of go back into the ready pose where he's holding the handles of it. It seems really, really cool.
I think that's awesome.
And this was another kind of idea of that, like, you know, the asymmetric armor. It's all about like the shoulder stuff. And I think this was a more like caber-ish exploration of like maybe he's like gonna hold it and like fling it onto a dude or whatever.
Yeah.
So these were thinking about weaponizing them a little bit more, right?
Yeah.
And the problem with this is that putting a hilt on it, it really just became sort of like a big two-handed club or two-handed mace or something like that. Mm. Took it away from the unique idea of using the battering ram thing. So we were like, you know, again, it's like, it's cool to explore these ideas. Also, some awesome things came out of here. The single shoulder shield is like super badass. A lot of people really like that. So now we're getting into the revisions, and I think the armor revisions are super rad. The weapon stuff became a little too metallic and like futuristic, I think.
Yeah, it's looking pretty futuristic.
It is looking a little too futuristic. Yeah. Again, you see on this one those 45 degree angles, and this one here that just kind of take it into tech land immediately. Mm. So. We've got some ideas about how to get it out of future place.
It's kind of weird because a lot of the style in this game is very angular. And I have a lot of these jangles, so I immediately did that for the weapons, and it automatically made them sci-fi.
Made
weapons.
Them sci-fi. That's totally crazy. It's totally crazy. This one should have a boxing glove on the end of it too, which I love. But it's like, I think that we're gonna get there with this guy, and he's super awesome. Also, I like that some of these have like more feminine shapes on them too. I like that when you draw these, sometimes they look like ladies as well. Okay, so the next one is really undefined. We're really solid. We really want to move forward with those four, and then we're like, you know, we feel like there should be five, just mainly because of the gameplay of retiring your heroes into the keeps. We're planning on having three keeps that you can retire heroes into at the start of the game, and having more classes than keeps makes it so that each playthrough will be different based on which heroes you retire. So we feel like we need a fifth one, and we want it to be melee. We want it to be melee. So one of the ideas was a falconer, which is a dude with a falcon. And these shapes are really cool. Like, I really like this. People really love the falconer.
They do.
And this kind of came before we knew we wanted the fifth one to be melee.
Yep.
So, I mean, the idea of this guy is more about like being a summoner caster, being able to
uses Falcon to go out and do stuff. But then we got inspired by the one on the
by left. By this one on the left, yeah. This one right here, this is such a rad idea. I really like it, where the Falcons have to, like, you know, their talons are really vicious, and the guys that take these things falconing. Can you go falconing?
Yeah.
Hawking? Sure. I don't know, whatever. They have to have these really thick, I think it's leather, like a really thick leather shoulder or like arm guard that the Falcon lands on and kind of digs into. And so Derek's idea was like, what if that was actually like weaponized? Like, what if the gauntlet, it's like this big, you know, these big fighter gauntlets.
Fighter gauntlets.
That the dude has, and the Falcon lands on them. And then, so he's sending the Falcon out to do stuff, and then he's just punching the shit out of dudes. Like, seems awesome. Yeah. And I mean, it does have, I think there's a little bit of that dissonance where, you know, you see a guy with a Falcon, you're gonna think that he's a ranged character that just uses the Falcon only to attack. It does water down the Falcon a little bit if he's also like punching guys. So I don't know. It's very cool though. I like it a lot. And you know, so
but
it's
we
still
also discussed ways you can use a Falcon not necessarily in an attack mess like thing, right?
Right.
It could, like, you know, you could just be a brawler who's a badass, but also your Falcon just takes away some fog of war, you know? Mm-hmm. It could be you got secondary abilities there.
Yep. The other idea that we have, you know, some of these things, some of these armor ideas here are very similar to the Arbalest. And you know, if they're, you know, so what if we just give a Falcon to the Arbalest? Sweet. Like, that would be a total way of solving it.
And you could shoot Falcons from his bow.
Shooting Falcons out of the bow. The next idea that we had was, like, a light melee class that's based off of, like, a circus performer, like a sword swallower, fire breather, acrobat, knife character. And that was like, oh, look, we just did some early base exploration of that, and there was some of that bullfighter stuff in there.
Right, being able to kind of get out of the way of attacks, do some like cone-based damage, like fire breathing is pretty sweet, and also looking at like Danny Trejo and machete or Desperado,
yeah.
You know, like knife throwing dude.
A bunch of knives, and that so one
just,
is like
just an idea.
There was not a super ton of support for that guy. The next one was the Time Mage.
Yes.
So this was, you know, like we had it on the list, and a lot of the, you know, time magic stuff that we've talked about in the past seems really cool. But after talking about it, it's like those four base classes, we've managed to avoid magic pretty much altogether for the human heroes. And so I think that where we're headed is that the real sort of magical items will be demon items that you research and use. So I don't think that we're actually going to have like a wizard or a mage, even though these are really cool. I like the, I'm trying to stay away from that because it's hilarious. I like the sand whip idea, is that he's got like flowing sand coming off of
that's
his hands
awesome
or his robes.
Idea, like,
and then he can use that as a whip, and like that's super cool.
Like,
also,
you know, it reminds me of in the Spider-Man where they had the Sandman, and when you show him being formed in the nuclear reactor and like the sand kind of comes together to form him, like, I don't know. I know it's like, it's awesome. I want
also,
a sand whip.
Time buddies.
Yeah.
Maybe you can summon little time buddies that run around. I don't know what this was. It was just awesome. And then the next one, we're calling this a demonologist, but the idea for this guy is that he would be kind of like a lancer in traditional tactics games, where he can attack. He's a melee character, but can attack one or two squares away, which is great. Like, I think that we have two core melee classes, two core range classes, and then we have this one that is like, you know, slight, you know, in between. He's like, he can attack from a couple squares away. That seems cool. And this is sort of like Indiana Jones, Simon Belmont, and a warlock.
Dr. Grant from Jurassic Park.
Yeah, right. Sort of all rolled together into this character. So we're just kind of doing some exploration on this class to see if that would be something interesting. I really like the idea of a, you know, a whip or a chain or something that can hit two squares away. Oh, there was another one I want to talk to you guys about that came from the forums, which is like a battlesmith, like a blacksmith who's like built for the battlefield. And I was thinking, like, what if the blacksmith hammer actually had a chain on it? So it's either an extending chain,
right.
or it's just a chain whip that has a hammer head on the end of it.
An anvil on the end.
Or an anvil, a little anvil. That would.
What if he carries on an anvil and puts people's head on, like, you're an idiot.
Just get it. Yeah, just carries an anvil on his back. I don't know. It's kind of interesting though, thinking about that, because it was actually came right from the forums, and I think it was Eric Fong. one of our big backers, because we showed him this stuff a couple weeks ago when he was here at the office, and he posted and he was talking about, we're talking about a butcher as a possibility, because we really like the apron kind of whatever, and dual wielding, it sort of fits this thing, but it's kind of dark and like gross, like a dude that's like
Brad,
a butcher.
It's crazy you mentioned Eric Vid Icarus, correct? He's on our chat right now.
Yeah, right. David, right?
That's right. And they just came up, another one, Vid Icarus just came up with Chronomancer for the time.
Chronomancer.
I don't know, it's just cool to, like, this back just kind of nudge on the whole backer thing. It's awesome, man. So many dialogue.
What was that, the Smith guy? What was
the
he
Battlesmith.
Called? Battlesmith, yeah. What if he smithed weapons that hung on a chain from his hammer? So he, like, makes them better as he's fighting or something.
That would be sweet. That would be cool.
He's got, like, a keychain of weapons that, like, dangle from it.
He has a little mini anvil that he can plow and just forge them on the
ooh, and on his back is like a bag of flaming coal so we can get the iron really hot and then get on there and tinker it.
That'd be really totally cool. Sweet.
Yeah, so we're going to be doing more exploration on these as we move forward, and it'll be awesome. And holy crap, it's 5:30. So are there questions about classes? And any questions specifically for Derek about, like, what would you call this process, like, of this? What?
Audio problems.
Audio problems. We'll be right back.